I found it on Rhema Radio.
This week's sermon is shared by Joy Yee on the 18th of March 2017 at Renewal Lutheran Church, entitled Restful Security.
In Joshua 5 verse 10,
on the evening of the 14th day of the month, while camped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, the Israelites celebrated the Passover. The day after the Passover, that very day, they ate some of the produce of the land, unleavened bread and roasted grain. The manna stopped the day after they ate this food from the land. There was no longer any manna for the Israelites, but that year they ate the produce of Canaan.
See, in other translations, right, they say that the Israelites ate the food of the land. But in this translation, it says they ate some of the produce of the land. In other translations, they say that they invaded a garden and they ate some of the produce of the land. See, Canaan is a very, very big land. It's owned by few different kings. It's not just owned by one Canaan king. There's few other kings. And here, there's this newly appointed leader called Joshua. And he was asked to lead the Israelites into the land. See, Canaan was big. And one of it was Jericho. And it sits in a valley low. Jericho, last time in the olden days, was known as the city of palm trees. Because in the middle of the desert, there's an oasis there. And it's one of the best places for civilization. You know, you learn your tamadon, where's the best place for humans to, you know, like, live and all. Why does Joshua need to conquer Jericho at all? Ever thought of that? Like, why can't he just live peacefully next to Jericho? Why does he need to conquer something? How come God can't just, you know, send down his angels and then wipe out all the Canaanite kings and then the Israelites just walk in and, like, okay, this is my land now. But why does he have to face that problem? Just like our driving license. Failed so many times, still have to retake. Now every time I sit for my driving license, right, sitting there on the chair, waiting for them to call your name, you know, and you're just so nervous, but you know you still have to go through it to get your license. We tend to think that a life with God is a life walking, you know, like got rainbows and clouds, you know. We think that it's so simple. And the truth is, everyone faces challenges, but God wants to be with you even through it. And firstly, God has more than just some of the produce. He promised a land flowing with milk and honey. So now there's this problem to Joshua, fight or flight. Remember we learned in physics, fight or flight. You know, when you're faced with Jericho, if you fight, most of your men will die. Why? Because it's an impenetrable city. Nobody can fight against those walls. If you flight, you make the same mistakes as the parents did. Spend 40 years in the desert. And the thing is, we can't keep running away every time there's an obstacle. Just like how when I study physics, I have a tuition teacher last time. He has like really long moustache. No, and then he likes to turn the moustache. I don't know why he likes to turn the moustache. So when he taught me, and then he used to say, Joy, you can't keep running from the problem. I have to give you exercises to help you improve in physics. And then every time I say, no lah, just start from the first chapter. I can do the first chapter. Why do we need to go the other chapters? And he always said, when the problem comes at you, you take the bull by the horn. And I always wonder, what's this kind of dumb, right? If the bull comes at you, shouldn't you run away? But he was saying, when the problem comes at you, don't run away. Just like how baby David, when he learned how to walk, he always fall down and he always cry. But now he can run. Now he can climb. Now he's jumping all over the place. And despite the problem, God wanted to remind them that every step with him is a miracle. Then they estimated 2.4 million Israelites that were living in the Exodus. And God wanted to show them the feeding in the desert was a miracle. The rock split and gave water. That was a miracle. The manna in the desert was a miracle. The meat that God provided was also a miracle. He made the bitter water sweet. And also now they are eating the produce of the land. Every single step was a miracle. And every single step was difficult. In Joshua 5 verse 13,
now when Joshua was near Jericho, he looked up and saw a man standing in front of him with a drawn sword in his hand. Joshua went up to him and asked, are you for us or for our enemies?
So when Joshua saw the man, he looked up. That means all this while he must have been looking down. There could be a few reasons why. Number one, he could be negative. Number two, he could be like those, you know, have you seen those movies, the Chinese generals, when they plan for war, they put the map and then they put their toy soldiers and their toy horses and then they're like, okay, you know, like how to plan their strategies and all that. The third way is also that he could be simply looking down at Jericho, because Jericho was a low land. It was an oasis. Out of all the desert, Jericho was green, it was fertile, it was lush. And in the True Living Bible translation,
as Joshua was sizing up the city of Jericho, a man appeared nearby with a drawn sword. Joshua strode over to him and demanded, "Are you friend or foe?"
See, in this translation, it says that Joshua was sizing up. What does it mean by sizing up? Sizing up, when you're going to fight someone, right? Say I want to fight with the ADC now. How do you size them up? See how strong they are, see how many biceps, how tall, see whether I can take or not. Okay? That's what it means to size up, and that's what Joshua was doing. See, with all these strategy plans, right, it's easy to get discouraged. Because the Israelites, they are not actual armies. They are actually farmers, they are agricultural, they have their own stock. They don't really have an identity. They don't come from any kingdom. They came from one man, Abraham. And that's exactly what Joshua did. He was listing out his possible strategies because he was stuck, fight or flight. And it says in the Bible that the man had a sword drawn. What does it mean by a sword drawn? It means your preparation is done. Training is done. Your workout done. Stamina, all prep, all ready. You are ready to fight. And that was God standing behind. In Joshua 5, verse 14,
"I am the commander-in-chief of the Lord's army," he replied.
See, Joshua says, "I need to defeat Jericho." But now God was saying, yeah, same. Jericho is also my problem. I also need to fight them. God was saying this, it was his problem also. And in Joshua 5, verse 14,
"I am the commander-in-chief of the Lord's army," he replied.
Verse 15,
"Joshua fell to the ground before him and worshipped him and said, 'Give me your command. Take off your shoes,' the commander told him, 'for this is holy ground.' And Joshua did."
This was exactly the same as Moses. When Moses was in front of the burning bush, God also instructed him to take out his shoes. See, God was trying to say, recognize my presence is there. Know that my presence is there. It's a reminder that his presence is with them. Moses knew this was God's battle. Number three, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. So, began to settle away just as soon as God has stepped in. And in Joshua 5, verse 1,
"When the nations west of the Jordan River, the Amorites and Canaanites who lived along the Mediterranean coast, heard that the Lord had dried up the Jordan River so the people of Israel could cross, their courage melted away completely and they were paralyzed with fear."
See, the Amorites and the Canaanites, they thought that the river was their defense. The Israelites were on the other side. Canaanites were here. They thought the river would surely stop them. But it didn't. And in NLT version,
"They lost heart and were paralyzed with fear because of them."
Young's literal,
"That their heart is melted and that there hath not been in them any more spirit because of the presence of the sons of Israel."
See, great things can happen when you let God take control, when his presence is there. In 1887, right, there were local Egyptians who dug up some artifacts in Egypt, this place called Amarna. And they found these Amarna tablets. Okay, so these Amarna tablets, right, were official diplomatic letters. And in those days, they didn't have scrolls. So they wrote it on tablets, which is clay. So they found like nearly hundreds of these. And they were wondering, what is this? See, there were many letters written by the Canaanite kings to the Egyptian pharaohs at that time, complaining about a group of people called the Habiru. They said, "Lost are the lands of the kings." This was from people, the kings of Megiddo, of Tyre, of Sidon. And they traced back they did their carbon dating, and they traced back this was the exact time when Joshua was carrying out his conquest of the Canaan land. And the people they were talking about were the Hebrews. Hapiru, Hebrew. And in those days, Hapiru were known to be people without an identity. They didn't have a nation. They didn't have any social identity. People looked down on them. They were wanderers, roamers. They didn't have a home. They were nomads, basically. And they talked about this certain type of people called the Hapiru was conquering the land with great force. At that time, nobody even knew what a Hapiru was until these tablets were discovered. Even the root word, the root meaning of Hebrew is actually wanderer, the one who wanders, the one who passes. So they were really talking about the Hebrews. And the Hapirus were mainly foreigners, not necessarily Hebrews, but the Hebrews were definitely foreigners. And in 1 Peter 2 verse 9,
"But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, to proclaim the virtues of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy."
So in one of the Amana letters, they did the translation. It said, "May the king, my lord, the sun from the sky, take thought for his land, the Pharaoh's land. Since the Hapiru are stronger than we, may the king, my lord, give me help, lest the Hapiru destroy us." Second one, "Hapiru has taken the very cities of the king. Not a single mayor remains to the king. My lord, all are lost." And the third one, "The land of the king deserted to the Hapiru. If there are no archers, the land of the king will desert to the Hapiru." So what this means is that at that time, there were this special group of people that were conquering the lands. In fact, taking all of Pharaoh's lands. And the people were very scared of them. Similar to what Rahab said to Joshua. Joshua 2 verse 9.
"I know the Lord has given you this land," she told them. "We are all afraid of you. Everyone in the land is living in terror. For we have heard how the Lord made a dry path for you through the Red Sea when you left Egypt. And we know what you did to Sihon and Og, the two Amorite kings east of the Jordan River, whose people you completely destroyed. No wonder our hearts have melted in fear. No one has the courage to fight after hearing such things. For the Lord your God is the supreme God of the heavens above and the earth below."
See, they also found in the Assyrian temples, they wrote down the Hapiru as a divine being, something that had special divine connection with above. And also in all their treaties, they would write treaties as in contracts between the kingdoms. They would write in the name of the Hapiru gods. So they recognized who was this Hapiru gods. It was God himself. And God told Joshua, "Be strong and very courageous." And you see the tremendous victory. Joshua could have said, "You know what, I'm really scared. You know, there's these big walls and I'm called by God to conquer all these Canaanite lands." When the truth is, all the Canaanite kings were so scared of them and they were wiped out completely. But you know what the weird thing is? No matter how beautiful Jericho is, God still asked Joshua to destroy it. Anybody know why? Sounds a bit weird, right? When you see an oasis, you thought, "God, this blessing must be for me. It's an oasis, it's green, it's fertile, it's the best place for us to, you know, stock up on our food, take more artillery, maybe for our own, get some clothes, eat, get our strength." But God said, "Destroy everything completely." And he even cursed Jericho, and Joshua even cursed those who tried to rebuild it. Deuteronomy 7 verse 1.
"When the Lord your God brings you into the land which you go to possess and has cast out many nations before you, the Hittites and Girgashites and the Amorites and the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than you. And when the Lord your God delivers them over to you, you shall conquer them and utterly destroy them. For you are a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for himself, a special treasure above all the peoples on the face of the earth."
You see, it seems a bit harsh, isn't it? God says, destroy everything. You must burn Jericho to the ground. No matter how rich it is, it has all the gold, all the diamonds, rubies, whatever, all the riches, all the swords, even the food. You must burn everything to the ground. Sounds weird, right? And there was one soldier who didn't obey God. He stole a rope. And God said, no, cannot. You cannot have anything to do with Jericho. You must destroy it completely. And why did God say this? He said, those people were living in sin. All the goods had been in sin already. It was a product of sin, and there was no mixing with the Israelites. God didn't want a single touch of it, no relationship with it, no goods of it, and the blood was not to mix. It was not to distract the Israelites to other gods and cause them to be impure. See, when they enter into the promised land, God didn't want them to take in the corrupt practices of the Canaanites. What are those? They practiced child sacrifices, and they were also into idolatry, prostitution, everything. They weren't following in God's ways. And just like Jericho is an oasis, sometimes it looks like God wants to stop us from the good things. God, you asked me to go after this rich land, now you want me to destroy it. Then why can't you just send fire from heaven and then just like kill them off? Why you need me to do it? And the oasis looks good, looks healthy. It looks good for us. When the truth is, God knew inside is rotten. And when the minute you mix with that, it's going to affect you also. In Proverbs 10 verse 22,
the blessings from the Lord makes a person rich and he adds no sorrow to it.
See, God wants to give you blessings that will actually last. Sometimes you wonder, why God, you write all these weird rules in the Bible, like no sex before marriage, but all my friends are doing it, they're even talking about it. Why do you put all these kind of rules in the Bible? Make us Christians look so conservative and then the media keeps making fun of us and all. Why do you give us all these rules? See, God didn't give us rules just to make us suffer. See, God's not that kind of lawmaker. See, God knew the consequences of what would happen. In the NIV version,
the blessings of the Lord brings wealth without painful toil for it.
You see, the Habiru, within time, they were lost from the records. You know, after the conquest, nobody knew about them until the tablets were found. So that means at some point of time, they found their identity. And that was being the Israelites, the people of God. They found their identity again. God had chosen them. Obscure, isn't it? They are the outcasts. People look at them with contempt. They say, ugh, those wanderers, those people. And yet God raised them up. If I was God, I'd probably like give up on them already because they keep turning away. See, but God never gave up at all. No matter how many times they rebelled against Him and then they made a golden calf, God still never gave up on them. Just like He's not going to give up on us also.
You have just heard a sermon from Joy Yee. For more sermons shared in Renewal Lutheran Church, log on to overseasofcare.org.
Hi everyone, I'm Reverend Trifina here. I just want to share with you a good news that I will be speaking very soon in a festival for 2017, which will take place in the end of May and also early June. Some of the topics I'll be speaking there will be understanding the complexities and possible causation of homosexuality, as well as another topic that I'll be touching is how you can journey or engage with those who are LGBT. So you want to find out more about what is happening in the festival and also the sessions that I'll be speaking, the time as well as the date, why not you just go to facebook.com/youthfestival, F-A-I-R-S-T-I-V-A-L, and you can find out more. See you there.
Sign up for STOMP, Short-Term Operation Relief Mission, a life-changing experience for youth and young adults. We're looking for volunteers who are willing and daring to experience life outside of their comfort zone. Come and make a difference in rural communities in Cambodia as well as Sabah. You can get more information at terencedeb.com/storm, S-T-O-R-M. Come and make a difference.
Hi, my name is Mark Grunden. I attend PJEFC, Petaling Jaya Evangelical Free Church, and this is my testimony. I am an American who lives in Malaysia, married to a Malaysian. My wife is ethnically Chinese, and we met in the U.S. while we were in university. The testimony that I want to share today is about God's faithfulness to us and His requirement of us. My wife and I got married shortly after we graduated, partly because we wanted to start life together and partly out of necessity because in order to make life happen in the United States, she needed to have a visa beyond her student visa. So getting married is the easiest way to facilitate that. So she was a year behind me in school, and as she's coming up to her graduation point, we had to find her a job in order for her to go home and then come back again so that we could get married. The other way we could do it is that we just get married first, and that she, right after graduation, we get married, and then she would have to wait until all the paperwork is done for her to have her travel papers to go back home. And so for us, she really didn't want that. She really wanted to bring closure to her home in Malaysia, to be able to see her family and her friends as she was starting life, really, which was not the original plan of hers when she went to college in the U.S. So my role was to try to help her find a job, and it wasn't easy. I was well-networked within my church. My church was fairly large for our area. It was about 1,000-plus people, and I spoke to everybody that we could find. And finally, weeks came up. I remember it was my birthday. It was in April, and school gets out in May. And, you know, people ask me, "Mark, what do you want for your birthday?" And I'd say, "I only want a job for Alicia, my wife." And so it was getting a couple of weeks out, and we said, "Okay, we're going to set a deadline. We're going to ask the Lord to move in this time. And if He doesn't, His will is clear that we are going to, that you can't go home, but that's not our heart's desire." So we prayed and we prayed and we prayed. And it was the day of the deadline, and there was no job in hand. And we said, "Okay," we were crushed. We're like, this is not what we're hoping for. And so finally, in the quiet of my heart, I said to myself, "Okay, Lord, you know what is in our heart, but we've exhausted our resources. I've looked everywhere I can. I've worked as hard as I can. I've been applying for jobs and talking to everybody, but it just can't happen. And so, Lord, if anything, we're going to push this deadline 2 more days. And if anything can happen, Lord, it's because of you, because I can't do it anymore." And I came to this point of surrender of saying, "Lord, in my own effort, I've tried everything, but I can no longer do it." The next day, I was driving on the highway from my workplace to my home. It was about a half-hour drive. And on there, a car was like driving up and down, like just driving very poorly. And I was getting very irritated because I was very focused on this heart's desire of mine. And so I look over, and the reason why the car was driving so crazy is because they were trying to get my attention. It was a schoolmate that I hadn't seen probably in 4 years. And they were waving at me, and they happened to live in the next exit. So they pull off in the exit. I follow them. Oh, we get talking and chatting, and they say, "What's happening in life?" I share them my story, what we're looking for. And they said, "Hey, somebody that I do work for is actually looking for somebody. It's this other school friend that we have, and they're actually looking for this particular position that would fit your wife perfectly." The next day I call that friend, that long lost friend of mine, within 8 hours, the interview happens and the employment papers are signed, and we have a job for my wife. I was dumbfounded. And you drive down the highway, and number one, you never see somebody that you know that's going to wave you down for ice cream, let alone a potential job for your future spouse. And so at that moment, I realized what the Lord requires of us in life is a life of surrender. That in my own effort, I can do everything I can, but in reality, the Lord wants to take glory for it, because He is the one that gives me everything. He gives me my health. He gives me my talent and my skills. If I would have gotten that job, I would have felt pretty good about myself and the network that I had. But it wasn't until I had exhausted all resources that the Lord was able to step in and say, "I am faithful to you. I do know what is on your heart, and I will bless you. But I need you to know that the things that come to you are not because of your own doing, but because of what I have given you." And that was a powerful lesson to have.
Hi, this is John Malcolm. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Church in Hong Kong. And my favorite Bible verse is Ephesians 3:20. And it says, "Now unto Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all I ask or think, according to the power that worketh in me." Amen.
Hi, my name is Heidi and from X Church. Today, I'd just like to pray for the young people in our country. Father, I thank you, Lord, for the campus students, for really an opportunity to pursue higher education. And Father, I pray that even as we pursue higher education, Lord Jesus, may we find our purpose and calling in you before we enter the marketplace, Lord. Father, we pray for your leading guidance and just your preparation, Lord Jesus, for us even before we enter the marketplace. Let us be examples of your love to the people around us and help us work not for profit but for purpose, Lord. Father, we thank you really for the privilege, Lord Jesus, of being able to pursue higher education. Father, may we use this privilege given to us, opportunity given to us for your glory, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, I pray.
There is a river of life that flows from beneath the Father's throne, desiring for lives to fill, promising freshness, joy and peace beyond compare, healing abundant life in the power and might of this everlasting flow. Let us arise, arise, children of God, arise, drink of Him and see from within you flow streams of living water. So arise, arise, children of God, arise, to become all that you are meant to be and even more. The leases of life, life-born vessels, going wherever He leads. One in heart and mind and will, His purpose is to fulfill. Until the bride of Christ be made ready for her groom, pure as so glorious in the fullness of her redemptive destiny.
Episode features music from Catherine Wong. Today's episode is edited by Veronica Ng. We would love to hear from you, especially if you have testimony to share. Write to us at hello@rhema.io. Stream or download new episodes weekly on Friday or Saturday evening. If you have not listened to Tommy Chan on his journey with God as a fine art artist, listen to his interview in the last segment. Catch the interview with Reverend Dr. Tony Lim from Malaysia Bible Seminar MBS on God's Calling in a coming episode next week.
Releases of life.
You're listening to Rhema Radio,